So we are going into the final game of today. Whereas the final game of today is not the final finals, but it's the decider. So that's pretty important. Okay, so let me check whether everything is set up fine, and then we go. This is this. Perfect. Bang wing. Okay, so as we said, this is the decider of the group A. So whoever wins advances into the next stage, and whoever loses here busts out. We are playing Conquest, best of five, with Pavel having this quiet control heavy control priest against a druid. Usually a very, very bad matchup, because priest is actually responsive and druid, well, is actually not needed to have like such a big board to actually kill, because it's for druid with the combo is usually enough to have like 1-2 minions deployed on the board. So what you need to do against druid is usually keep the board completely clean if you want to survive. But this is exactly what priest can exactly not do. Like priest can actually answer big boards, but priest cannot answer small boards, and this is also the reason why usually it's a very, very good matchup for the druid. And you can also already see it here. Ancient of Lore coming down into double Savage Roar. Yeah. I mean, Hoi is just threatening lethal right away. Already now. Like, oh, actually, Jacob left us because he needed to do some other stuff. Which also means I need to have my evening lunch here. Okay. So this is like 19 damage Pavel is actually facing here. We see a Wild Rose, and Hoi is actually going surprisingly... No, not surprisingly. Like, Hoi is kind of going all in here just because he drew all the combo pieces. And he knows exactly that Pavel has to do a lot to actually prevent this. And a lot means, why? It's really not possible. Pavel would have needed to play Heal and Borgdir. Or Heal and Taunt. Yeah, a combination of one of those. Yeah, Pavel already knows. So that was a pretty quick one, actually. Was this like 2 minutes? Yeah, I think it was something like 2 minutes. That's pretty fast. And yeah, the guy's just joining the next one immediately. So now we got Pavel with his priest again. We know from Hoi that he actually brought Paladin and also a Patron Warrior. So priest will have like chances to actually come back at some point. Hoi is playing like druid, warrior and paladin, and he just cleared his druid, whereas Pravel is actually playing priest, mage and warrior. We know from the mage that it's actually freeze mage, and that means that Hoi's warrior is already kind of cleared. What I'm saying is, if Hoi can actually clear his paladin and Pavel's priest mage isn't cleared, that's the match point here. Very likely. So we see a knife juggler here, and obviously like the knife juggler is the only drop. And before you actually token up, of course, you want to drop the knife juggler. There's no way that you don't drop the knife juggler. Of course, you are afraid of certain things. But this is an aggressive deck. You have to drop the knife juggler when you can. We see a white pyromancer and a coin power red shield here. Into a circle of, or into a circle of healing, actually, yeah. I mean, it doesn't matter. You can, if you do this like this, well, actually, every circle of healing draws three cards. Yeah. Paul is actually considering even using the other circle of healing. It's simply circle of healing for three cards. You should probably very much do that. 2, 4, 6 cards, so he could replenish his hand to 8 cards with this. I think that's definitely a good thing to do. It's just like circle of healing for three cards. I mean, why shouldn't you do that? And afterwards there will be power word. If there was even like, I guess the reasoning behind this is that Pavel actually wants to I think the reasoning here is that Pavel actually wanted to save the circle of healing for potential Okanai circle clear. I still don't know whether this circle is really worth 3 cards, but we will see. I think it's quite a close decision. I can put a little bit of game music on, but I don't know, whatever. Yeah, the Hearthstone will do. Then rather not, but okay. So, Priest is completely ceding the control of the board every turn. And as long as Priest has the control, it's clear that Paladin cannot do anything. And here, yeah, it's pretty much decided. With the mysterious challenger, Pavel can actually pull out all the secrets of his deck. No, but seriously, it's like Priest simply has like the full hand and I mean, Paladin has Dr. 6 and Dr. 7 and Dr. 8, so it could be pretty tricky. But on the other hand, Pavel also has like kind of good answers. Cabal Shadow Priest, having like Sylvanas, having Mind Control, probably not fast enough, but having the Owl against Tyrion. So there are tools. There are definitely tools to handle what's happening here. That Mind Change... That's interesting, but I think it's good, yeah. Competitive string going into nothing. I also like very much that Pavel actually like, because he played it like this, he actually simply prevented the whole 7 damage which were incoming from the mysterious challenger. So very good play here from Pavel. Yeah, Shadow or Death, obviously that helps quite a lot. Mm-hmm. could have actually cleared like no, let me clear. What paramancer, circle of healing into shadow of death? Yeah, it's close anyways. Ooh, the owl, and now there's Tyrion. That's pretty insane. It's pretty good in time. Yeah, that was a little bit bad timing with the owl, I guess. But what can you do about it? I guess sometimes it's what it is. But that could eventually, I mean, however unlikely, but it's not like after what just happened, Paul is definitely not in the situation or in the position we thought he has been like a minute ago, actually. It was just a huge swing. Like, what was it exactly? I guess perhaps Pavel could have like Pyromancer, Circle of Healing, then it would have dealt one damage area, like first, like before Shadow of Deathing, and before actually proking the challenger, before proking the token, because like he attacked, and because the Avenge went onto one of the other minions, that got problematic. On the other hand, he could have played Pyromancer, yeah, but like Circle of Healing would have been a way, it would have not made so much sense. But now Pavel is really in a lot of trouble here. It's really not looking that good, suddenly. I mean, not that good. I mean, there is still a Belcher, it still soaks up damage, but on the other hand, there will be this 5-3 avenging weapon. And the 5-3 weapon could really be huge. Especially because Mind Control is just this one little turn too slow. Like, the Tyrion will be able to get sacrificed before turn 10, and Hoi watched the match, the games for sure, so he knows that Pavel actually runs Mind Control, and he will play around that for sure, because, like, the weapon could potentially simply win him the game. On the other hand, if Tyrion would get Mind Controlled, that would be, like, the out for Pavel to actually simply win right away. Like a Mind Control Tyrion simply wins right away. Also very good the Belcher, simply blocking it off. Simply blocking also the 7-4 from actually dying, which is also very huge. Blademaster and guys simply not doing anything for Pavel. Not even Sylvanas is doing anything. The reason for that is because she can only trigger like the turn after. So Sylvanas will take effect the turn after, which will make her actually useless for the turn being, or for the time being. So Pavel actually needs to top deck here. And Light of Naru is not exactly doing the job. It saves a little bit. The Avenge also so ridiculously huge, if you think about it. I mean, usually if something would get 10-6, it would simply get like cleared, Mind Control, or whatever. But not in that case. Pavel even decided to give Hoi here the 5-3 weapon. We will see how this will pan out. It's already 20 damage on board for Hoi. Now, Redemption, not exactly what he wanted to see, but it's also not the end of the world, because, like, what will actually get redeemed? Yeah, could be the Belcher, but the Belcher, I think perhaps the Belcher could even get Mind Controlled. It's really close here. Shielded Mini would even probably attacking this 3-2. Yeah, I guess Pavel's plan is perhaps even to Mind Control the Belcher. It makes a lot of sense. And that could probably then also stabilize. Because it's like now, right away, it's like 20 damage if Hoi actually would decide to trade the bot into the 3-2. Then it would be like 18 damage. Bringing Pavel down to 9. But the mind control in the Belcher would change everything. Yeah, Redemption also pretty much like one of the worst cards Hoi could have drawn here. Probably costing him the game here. Let's see which attacks he chose to do. So exactly that, Hoi actually decides to bring Pavel down to 9 life. Here's Okanai, here's Circle of Healing, but there's especially the Mind Control. And the Mind Control being quite huge here. Is there some Circle of Healing action? Let's see. So if you actually, like, if Pavel would decide to play the Okanai. Yeah, so Pavel could decide to get the Mysterious Challenger here. Like, the play would be Sylvanas attacks the Belcher, then the 1-2 gets... there's also one secret. So it's not as easy as that. He made the attack, but there's this Redemption. But now, because Sylvanas was played first, before the Belcher actually popped, he can actually go for the clear. He can actually play Okanai, ping the minibot. He needs to ping the minibot if he wants to do that. Pinging the minibot and then playing Circle of Healing. And this will actually give him the Mysterious Challenger then. Like, he can also attack first. It doesn't really matter. What was the attack? That was bad, right? I mean, I don't know about the trigger proc, but it is that Sylvanas procs first and gets the attack. Like, I mean, with the Belcher, I mean, I don't know how it works with the Redemption, but I would assume that the Redemption is a new instance. So he could probably, it would have meant that Sylvanas would have played before Belcher. And then he could have actually played like Circle first, then the 1-2 spawns, and then he saves himself a 4-1, if that is how it works. But no matter what, Pavel won the game here. Okay, so what do we have here? We have the Patron against the Control Priest. And this is actually a pretty good cue in for Pavel, because like the Patron Warrior is probably slightly favored over Secret Paladin. Just slightly, but a little bit. Okay, so let's see. Hoi has quite a lot of tools. He actually drew all the small drops, so that's pretty insane. The only question is what to do here. Knife Juggler? Yeah, sounds reasonable. What about the secret? You want to play the secret, right? You'd want that your guy grows. You also know that Warrior doesn't have a Fiery Warrix. If you know that Warrior doesn't have a Fiery Warrix, that means your Knife Juggler also is safer than he should be. So definitely coining out the secret here. It's good in many respects. But you just want to make your guy bigger. That fight is pretty huge. But Frozen Berserk is curve, so you play Frozen. Paladin at this very moment simply out-tempos the Patron Warrior by quite a margin. But there is still the Whirlwind. Another cheap card. There is a possibility of having Master into Machine Gun Fire, but it's super vulnerable against Whirlwind. What we also see Pavel actually has in his hand. But Cockhammer also being a very strong weapon. Being a weapon which actually protects your minions right away. And the Secret is actually not even that bad of a draw. If you have a Secret Keeper online already, that's also an automatic +1/+1 buff. So that's also not that bad. So what would you play here? So who actually decides to attack the Berserk first? I'm a little bit curious what he's up to. Like, is that better than what? Yeah, the question was whether you like to have 2 damage on the Secret Keeper and 4 damage into your face, or whether you like to have a Divine Shield on your Secret Keeper. I'm not even sure. Like, what could have he done? Like, he could have played... So he decided to first attack the minion, then to attack the armorsmith, and then to attack, to face tank the guy. And he could have also first face tank the guy, then the weapon. No, which, okay, it's interesting, right? It depended on... The armorsmith had 2 health. Yeah, he could have first played the cockhammer. If this would have got the Divine Shield, then he would have done what we just said, saving himself 4 life and trading this few health. If this would have received the cockhammer, he could have simply attacked with this the Berserk. Like with this Berserk, with this, and this would have attacked the Secret Keeper, leaving him with no Divine Shield, but 1 more health and 4 more life. And yeah, and this with 1 more health. So that would have probably been better. Okay, so what do we see here? Paladin actually beating up the Patron. Patron Warrior actually really good if there would only be a Patron, right? If there would only be a Patron, guys. Yeah, if there would have only been 1 patron, it would have meant GG. 6 patrons on board. Yeah. We also talked about this, but this matchup, like this, this game is of uttermost importance. Like this matchup could potentially decide the outcome of the whole match. Simply because Ho is actually playing, playing Warrior, and Paul is actually playing Freeze Mage. Which means, well, it means exactly that. You know how the Warrior against Freeze Mage matchups are. Exactly, yeah. They are not very favorable. So what's with the Secret Paladin here? Like, Grim Patron really ran out of cards. Yeah, that's bad. That's pretty bad for Grim Patron Warrior. I mean, Paladin is also out of cards, but unfortunately for Pavel, Hui has the board control here in all respects. Okay, there's the Whirlwind still, and Hui just played the Master. That was also a question, right? I mean, whether you want to play the Master right away or whether you don't simply want to produce 1 minion. I guess there are reasonings for both. Probably it's better like this. Lothab being, by the way, a pretty good draw. Because Lothab actually converts the board control again. With Lothab, you actually receive the board control again. And now we are in top decking mode, right, guys? At the moment, the board is exactly equal. This doesn't do it. This going face, yes, exactly. Yeah. New minion and the 4-2 going face. Look at how close this is. It's so super close here. It's such a top decking battle, guys. Look at this. And now there is the consequence. I mean, it's just a, I mean, but in a top decking battle, Paladin should go. Oh, that Shredder is so huge. That could be potentially the matchup decider here. Doing this attacking with the minion and simply getting the Shredder online. It must be Shredder. There is nothing. Yeah, I mean, it's Shredder, not the token up, of course. And now Warriors, and yeah, there's the patron. He needs to play it, right? Yeah. He needs to play it. But it probably won't help. Competitive spirit, interesting. Such a bad draw. But you can even play it for zero. Not using the last weapon charge, right? It's probably something you want to keep, the last weapon charge, yeah. That's really wise. And yeah, there's a Dread Corsair. There's also the competitive spirit. And because Hoi actually correctly kept the last weapon charge, he can now use this and the weapon pair. Okay. We see a Tyrion Fodring. Congratulations, guys. This is like Mr. GG. I mean, we have to say it would have been over anyways. But yeah. So that gives Hoi a 2-1 lead. And well, but Pavel can now choose like what he wants, like whether he wants the Doom first or whether he wants to, yeah, like he can think about whether he wants to delay the inevitable. So let's see. So Pavel wants to make it more, yeah. He chooses a better matchup first, and it's reasonable, right? You want to get this 2-2, and then you want to try to squeeze in the 20% or whatever you have with Freeze Mage against Patron Warrior. Okay. So Pavel actually, I didn't see it exactly, but he kept one inner rage for sure, and that's for sure good. As I said, like the only thing in this matchup which actually matters at all are patrons. It's the only thing, nothing else. Yeah. So the only thing you have to take a look at, what are our patrons doing? Yeah, that's the thing. Oh, we see here the ghoul, so there could be coin into acolyte, and we know that. Oh. We know that he will, if he does this, Pavel is straight ahead, because we know that Hoi doesn't have a way to actually handle it, which is interesting, because I mean, Pavel probably wouldn't have done it if he would have had an, like, even any other play, because like Pavel should know that Hoi would never drop the ghoul if he would have a chance to convert the acolyte. Convert the ghoul into something which could kill the acolyte. On the other hand, well, Hoi had the follow-up acolyte, so it was not that bad. We see Pavel having now a patron into inner rage, so the only thing missing is any kind of whirlwind effect. Any kind of whirlwind effect being whirlwind or deathbite. Or, I mean, ghoul, not necessarily, because you cannot utilize the ghoul in this matchup, so it's really only death bites and whirlwinds. But also a second inner rage would be probably sufficient. Okay, we're seeing who is actually setting up the whirlwind. Not playing the pirate, just setting up the whirlwind. Oh, that's like, if Pavel simply plays death bite, here goes face, he will win. He simply plays death bite, here goes face, next turn patrons, GG. It's easier as that nowadays. There's also nothing Hoi could do about it. Because you can never, like with patron, you can never kill more than one full health patron. More than one full health patron. So that's actually simply the play. You could make an argument for playing the Shredder, but I guess not. So if you play the Shredder, you would simply delay your patron or your potential patron action. On the other hand, of course, it feels also weird to use the Deathbite, simply go face. It feels weird, but it's the right thing to do. Because the Deathbite into like patron inner rage simply wins you the game immediately. And there are also not that many drops we can actually do. In theory, Hui could like play three drops now, yeah. But usually it will be two or one drop. And if it's actually Berserk and Armorsmith, Pavel will simply play Patron Inner Rage and attack the Berserk, leaving the opponent like an Armorsmith, having four patrons from which like one can be handled by Execute. But the other one cannot even be attacked by the Deathbite, because the Whirlwind would actually eventually spawn new ones. So the only way how Hoi can actually prevent this would be basically what he just plays. Yeah, exactly. Which is also pretty... Well, I mean, it is a bad rage for three cards, so... It is kind of not bad. Oh. Pavel actually decides to do it anyways because he sees the weapon is out, but that's actually pretty interesting, because now Hoi could eventually really do something against these four patrons. I mean, as a matter of fact, he could clear one of those with a Berserk. He can execute one, and he can clear one with the Fiery Works. So Hoi can actually deal with it. So it's not over yet. Hoi will actually be able to deal with it. So how do you do it? You better rage first? Just to see what comes up. If it interests you. To see whether you draw a patron for which you could perhaps use the inner rage. You definitely weapon up into one of those 3/3s. I mean, that's for sure. Unless he would have drawn, for example, Grommash. Then perhaps he would have simply gone face with this and this, setting up for Grommash Leisure with a weapon. But in this case, that's a play. He drew Slam now, so he values Execute over Slam, and that's correct in this matchup for sure. So you should definitely stand that. That's for sure. And the only question remaining, there are actually two questions remaining. Question number one, should this go face or should this go on patron? Going this on patron is the correct play. And the other question is, would you inner rage this? And the answer would, I'm pretty positive that the answer would have been yes, if you would have not drawn this patron. But perhaps the answer should have been yes anyways, because the life count is also not that much, like Hoi's life count is already at 16. So it's kind of closer than it appears to be. At the moment it seems that Hoi's hand is actually better than Pavel's hand, but that could really change in a split second by Pavel better raging. And actually, I would have not mind to play this inner rage on this guy, because if you think about it, you gain 5 life right away for one card in your hand, so that's already not that bad. You kill a 5-1 on board, which is pretty good, additionally to the 5 life loss. And you prevent your opponent playing better rages. Yeah, so it's actually, yeah, it's actually quite a lot, to be honest. Actually quite a lot. So we see Dr. Boom coming down and using... using your face. quite ballsy, I have to say, right? Quite ballsy, like balls out of steel. Bad rages for 4. Nah, that's pretty insane. That was pretty insane. It looks like we would see like probably game 5. Probably. I mean, after all these actions, like getting infinite armor, bringing your opponent down quite low, getting 4 cards. Getting the execute handle for Dr. Boom. I mean, there is a lot of stuff going on, and especially about the life count. I mean, especially about the life total. So, Hoi being so low on life, he suddenly needs to actually keep the board clean. And that's really nothing easy, like, that's easier said than done if your opponent does have stuff like Shredders online. And so that will actually really, really hurt him. As a matter of fact, I don't even know how he is supposed to do it. Execute face. No, probably not. Execute shredder. It's so expensive, everything. Berserk taunt. Yeah. I mean, you see it yourself. That's game. Pavel also known to execute his moves very quickly. So this is also something you see here again. Pain, Wayne, Wayne. And Warrior wins. But that win is nothing where he can actually calm down on, because now it's his freeze mage, and you also know how that matchup is. Also taking a short look at the chat. Good. Okay. So let's see. Usually this matchup, the comment on this matchup is usually like, Warrior is armoring up and Freeze Mage is trying to prevent it from happening. Even Freeze Mage is even so that even the patron can simply outvalue Freeze Mage. It's not even close. It's interesting because usually you would think, yeah, perhaps like an aggressive deck could be outvalued by Freeze Mage, but it's simply not. Like, Freeze Mage has so less value in itself that usually it cannot outvalue. And Ho is also doing everything so that the outvalue doesn't happen, playing Acolytes, drawing a lot of cards. It makes a lot of sense. So how does Freeze Mage win? Well, he simply doesn't, unless a miracle occurs. Miracle usually being a lot of threats at the beginning and patron is not able to handle those. Usually doesn't happen. Oh, actually, there is one thing what can actually happen. And this is patron going somewhat crazy and beginning to overexpand and stuff like this. So, in general, Well, okay, it's not as clean up as a control warrior, for example. So we can actually take a look how it will work. I guess probably simply fatigue. So in this regard, the acolyte actually was a little bit even overambitious, I have to say. But yeah, you would actually never prevent or try to save your acolyte, by the way. Yeah, that the acolyte goes is perfectly fine. That's even good for you. I mean, the opponent wasted or used a doomsayer for your acolyte, it doesn't matter, right? Okay, so Pavel is actually drawing a lot of cards. So as a warrior, you can always draw as deep as the freeze mage does. So freeze mage is actually already at 18 cards. Yeah, of course, Hoi played the acolyte. Yeah, so freeze mage is already 3 cards deeper. So Hoi should just even draw as much as he can do. So as long as this is the case, yeah, because he can simply do that. Yeah. We see Pavel here actually trying to do exactly that. Like, he's just trying to draw the maximum amount of cards and then to make some combo with big guys happen. Drawing cards like crazy, basically. So he's already down at 14 cards, but that only means that Hoi can simply draw as many cards as he likes with the battle rage. He can just choose how many cards he likes to draw. And it's also like, this matchup is also very much about having like the suitable removal from the warrior side, but the warrior can actually, like, the warrior simply have an overlay of removals. To explain this, we have to understand how many threats the freeze mage actually does have. And the freeze mage does have like 3 threats, but not really. So it's like Alexstrasza, Antonidas, and then Sorosin, but Sorosin can also get handled by weapons. So it's basically only 2 big threats, and the Patron Warrior has at least 2 answers, but probably more to that. The only thing which Patron Warrior should not do is to give too much cannon fodder. So for example, a big board, which then gets Frostnovat into Doomsayat, could pose a problem. Okay. Yeah. I mean, this is interesting indeed, because now probably it's worse to execute the Doomsayer. So there will be, you will now see a slam and an execute, because there was also the second slam. But it's also about the Dr. Boom, which is already on the board. Well, the thing is, because there is so much on the board, I think Hoi is even committed to execute the Doomsayer. Yeah. Executing Doomsayer and armoring up again, it's perfectly fine. There's no rush, and especially Pavel is also running out of removals somewhat. Also out of freeze, not removals, I mean freeze. You see Pavel having like Antonidas and Alexstrasza in his hand. The missing part is Emperor Thorisson. And I guess he's thinking about digging for it. Yeah, putting on the Blood Mage just to have perhaps the option. But I don't even know what option. Hoi should probably even just ignore the Blood Mage. Or he could, I'm not saying he should, no, probably he shouldn't. But it's close, because there are also not real spells the mage wants to play. To just shortly explain it, of course all of his spells have spell power, but before his life total didn't get reduced to 15, before that happens, all the damage from mage is actually futile. The mage doesn't want to deal damage into your face. And that's the reason why you should probably simply let it live, to be honest. Because there are simply no spells Freeze Mage can actually play, and this is simply 4 damage into the opponent's face. Potentially you want to Whirlwind later anyways. And then the Blood Mage would die collateral. Or he really wants to draw this card, and then he will probably make the sacrifice for you. And then you also dealt 4 damage more into the opponent's face. There's also always like one very, very pretty good thing Warrior can actually do, which is like what you see also in Hoi's hand here, is Patron Armorsmith Double Whirlwind. Cool story, bro. Yeah, because then you get like infinite armors and it's like 14 cards against 9 cards. So there's 0.0 way that Hoi will lose the long game. So you will probably simply see Armorsmith Patron Double Whirlwind incoming here. And getting a lot of armor, which would be respectively like 9 armor right away. It's a lot. It's a lot. And it's not only about the 9 armor, by the way. It's also about the armor you gain when he needs to remove your board. And in order to remove your board, he usually needs Flamestruck or Blizzard. And that's another 6 to 7 armor. So with this action you just saw, he will probably get like 16, 17, 18 armor. And that's as much as 3 fireballs are. It's a lot. Everyone gets in here. Sorosin. There he is. The lost child. Okay, and here's the flame strike. What do we have? Grom with no activation, but we have Lothab. We have a weapon and execute. It's interesting. But this is like what I meant. So now Hoi actually does have only one execute left instead of 2. And 2 are needed, not 1. Yeah. Okay, on the other hand, I mean, he could clear Alexstrasza in another different way now. But that's exactly the thing. I mean, if he would have not been forced to actually use the execute on the Doomsayer, because he didn't overexpand or whatever. Nah, it's close. It's close. I don't know exactly. But it's definitely close. Yeah. The most important thing is to keep on your removal, and now one is simply gone. I know Alexstrasza ate one anyway, so but I'm just saying there could have been 2, on the other hand there wouldn't have been proc. So probably it was fine. Probably it was fine what happened. It's probably even, I mean, Freeze Mage drew 6 cards more, so yes, in Fatigue, Patron would have won, or would win. Oh, there's the Battle Rage. It's actually... Yeah, that's actually kind of important, because there will be a Lothab. There will be a Lothab, there will be an attack, then both are wounded, and then Hoi will be able to draw another 2 cards. And that's really important in this current board state. And then there will be a DX to kill Thorison without being needed to use a removal. And then he still have the removal for Intonator. So everything aligns perfectly. And here you also see the Inner Rage as a proc for the execute. Everything aligns perfectly. I'm saying that he needs a proc from the hand because the weapon is not a proc. Because what will happen with the Antoniders? Of course he doesn't play Antoniders now. Now he will simply fireball this even. Interest. Link Lee, you sure? I'm not sure whether you should use the fireball. Perhaps you should use a fireball on the face, but not on Lothab, right? He would probably end up with not having sufficient burn. Or does he want to... I don't mind killing the 5-4. He wants to buy time to actually be able to cast Pyroblast. And as it looks, he simply wants to perhaps even get like Antonidas into the potential to not even need to freeze the board, but just to freeze the weapon and that Antonidas survives. No, I actually like the fireball on the minion. Here's Antonidas. And you will now see fireball on that one, frostbolt into face, and ice lance into face. The reason He just says, okay, there must be execute in the hand, the second one, and there must be also activation in the hand, and otherwise Antoninus lives. If Antoninus lives, he will win. Okay, but we know there is inner rage and execute. Inner rage, execute, perhaps even playing Grommash. I think playing Grommash is correct here. Inner rage, execute Grommash and Dread Crosshair. You could also armor up, but Grom should be better than armor up, right? We could have done everything, right? Yeah. Like not armoring up, we should have still probably simply not armored up. It's not that easy. I mean, the one gives you 2 armor, the other one deals 4 damage in your opponent's face potentially. It's not that easy. You also need the armor because otherwise you will get burned down. Probably it's quite a close call. Perhaps armoring up is even fine. So how much burn do we see here? 28 burn. It is to be mentioned that there is 1 Ice Dance in the deck left, but the 1 Ice Dance in the deck left cannot be proc'd because both Frostbolts already has been seen play. So yeah, this is 1 turn and this is another turn. He goes to 19, but this will do the burst. But there should be 1 armor smith in there. So the Deathbite must be used to get the Whirlwind into Armorsmith, into this, and also into Grom. So he's doing that, trying to win the fatigue game. I'm a little bit curious whether it would have been better to exactly apply this Grom pressure. But it's also kind of like a long shot. So there will be double fireball. No, will there be double fireball? Probably fireball. Ice Lance to freeze. Bringing him to 10, he can only armor up 2. So there are no outs. Power really made it. I mean, there's always a possibility that this happens, but it's not very high. It usually is like at 20% or something. So, really good job here from Pavel, and quite unlucky for Hui, who already was 2-1 ahead. So that was actually quite a close one if you also take a look at the life count and the amount of burst left. I mean, there was not much left, so that was insanely close, and also a really, really nice last game. That was really cool.